Well, we interrupt the real deal because, as promised, we are bringing you that speech from Iranian President Mahmoud Ahmadinejad. You see him just there stepping up to the platform of the first day of the five-day Durban Review Conference in Geneva. Applause there for the President. Let's go in as he takes his place to listen to his speech.
In the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful. I would like to ask the respected audience to forgive these people. They are misinformed.
In the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful.
In the name of God, the compassionate, the merciful.
Praise be upon Allah, the Almighty, who is just kind.
God's praise be upon His Prophet and His holy household.
We thank the Almighty God, praise be upon Him, who is just and who is compassionate. And the salutations and regards of Allah to His prophets, from Noah to Abraham, Moses, Jesus Christ, and His last prophet Muhammad, peace be upon them all, who were the harbingers of monotheism, fraternity, love, human dignity, and justice. Mr. Chairman, Honorable Secretary General of the United Nations, Madam High Commissioner, ladies and gentlemen, we have gathered here in the follow-up to the Durban Conference against racism and racial discrimination to work out practical mechanisms for our holy and humanitarian campaigns. Over the last centuries, humanity has gone through tremendous sufferings and pains. In the medieval ages, thinkers and scientists were sentenced to death. It was then followed by a period of slavery and slave trade, when innocent people in millions were captivated and separated from their families and loved ones to be taken to Europe and America under worse conditions. A dark period that also experienced occupations, lootings, and massacres of innocent people. Many years passed by before nations rose up and fought for their liberty and freedom, and they paid a high price. They lost millions of lives to expel the occupiers and proclaim their independence. However, it did not take long that the coercive powers imposed two wars in Europe, which also plagued a part of Asia and Africa. Those horrific wars claimed about 100 million lives and left behind massive devastations. Had lessons been learned from the occupations, horrors and crimes of those wars, there would have been a ray of hope for the future. The victorious powers call themselves the conquerors of the world, while ignoring or downtreading the rights of other nations by the imposition of oppressive laws and international arrangements. Ladies and gentlemen, let us take a look at the UN Security Council, which is one of the legacies of the World War II and World War I. What was the logic behind their granting themselves the veto rights? How can such a logic comply with humanitarian or spiritual values? Could it be in conformity with the recognized principles of justice, equality before law, love and human dignity? Or rather, with discrimination, injustice, violation of human rights, or humiliation of the majority of nations and countries. That council is the highest decision-making world body for safeguarding the international peace and security. How can we expect the realization of justice and peace when discrimination is legalized and the origin of law is dominated by coercion and force rather than by justice and the right? Coercion and arrogance is the origin of oppression and wars. Although today many proponents of racism condemn racial discrimination in words and in their slogans, a number of powerful countries have been authorized to decide for other nations based on their own interests and at their own discretion, and they can easily ridicule and violate all laws and humanitarian values, as they have done so. Following the World War II, they resorted to military aggressions to make an entire nation homeless on the pretext of Jewish sufferings, and they sent migrants from Europe, the United States, and from other parts of the world in order to establish a totally racist government in the occupied Palestine. And in fact, in compensation, for the dire consequences of racism in Europe, thank you. And in fact, in compensation for the dire consequences of racism in Europe, they helped bring to power the most cruel and repressive racist regime in Palestine. The Security Council helped stabilize this occupation regime and supported it in the past 60 years, given them a free hand to continue their crimes. It is all the more regrettable that a number of Western governments and the United States have committed themselves to defend those racist perpetrators of genocide, whilst the awakened conscience and free-minded people of the world condemn aggressions, brutalities, and bombardments of civilians in Gaza. They have always been supportive or silent against their crimes. And before that, they have always been silent with regard to their crimes. Distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, what are the root causes of U.S. attacks against Iraq or invasion of Afghanistan? What are the root causes of U.S. attacks against Iraq or invasion of Afghanistan? Was the motive behind the invasion of Iraq anything other than the arrogance of the then U.S. administration and the mounting pressures on the part of the owner of wealth and power to expand their sphere of influence, seeking the interest of giant arms manufacturing companies affecting a noble culture with thousands of years of historical background, eliminating a potential and practical threats of Muslim countries against the usurper Zionist regime, or to control and plunder energy resources of the Iraqi people? Why indeed almost a million people were killed and injured, and a few more millions were displaced and became homeless? Why indeed the Iraqi people have suffered enormous losses amounting to hundreds of billions of dollars? And why was hundreds of billions of dollars imposed on the American people and its allies as a result of these military actions? Wasn't the military action against Iraq planned by the Zionists and their allies in the then U.S. administration in complicity with the arms manufacturing companies and the owner of the wealth? Did invasion of Afghanistan restore peace, security, and economic well-being in this country? The United States, did invasion of Afghanistan restore peace, security, and economic well-being in this country? The United States and its allies not only have failed to contain the production of drugs in Afghanistan, but also the illicit cultivation of narcotics multiplied in the course of their presence. The basic question is that what was the responsibility and job of the then U.S. administration and its allies? Did they represent countries of the world? Have they been mandated by them? Have they been authorized on behalf of the people of the world to interfere in all parts of the globe, and of course, mostly in our region? Aren't these measures a clear example of egocentrism, racism, discrimination, or infringement upon the dignity and independence of nations? Ladies and gentlemen, who are responsible for the current global economic crisis? Where did the crisis start from? From Africa? From Asia? Or was that first from the United States, then spreading to Europe and to their allies? For a long time, they imposed inequitable economic regulations by their political power on the international economy. They imposed a financial and a monetary system without a proper international oversight mechanisms on nations and governments that played no role in the repressive trends or policies. They have not even allowed their people to oversee or monitor their financial policies. They introduce all laws and regulations in defiance to all moral values, only to protect the interests of the owners of wealth and powers. They further presented a definition for market economy and competition that denied many of the economic opportunities that could be available to other countries of the world. They even transferred their problems to others, whilst the wave of crisis lashed back, plaguing their economies with thousands of billions of dollars in budget deficits. And today, they are injecting hundreds of billions of cash from the pockets of their own people into the failing banks, companies, and financial institutions, making the situation more and more complicated for their economy and their people. They are simply thinking about maintaining power and wealth. They couldn't care any less about the people of the world and even about their own people. Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, racism is rooted in the lack of knowledge concerning the truth of human existence as the selected creature of God. It is also the product of his deviation from the true path of human life and the obligations of mankind in the world of creation. Failing to consciously worship God, not being able to think about the philosophy of life or the path to perfection that are the main ingredients of divine and humanitarian values, have restricted the horizon of human outlook, making transient and limited interest a yardstick for his actions. That is why the cells of devil's power took shape and expanded its realm of power by depriving others from enjoying equitable and just opportunities to development. The result has been the making of an unbridled racism that is posing the most serious threat against the international peace and has hindered the way for building peaceful coexistence in the entire world. Undoubtedly, racism is the symbol of ignorance, which has deep roots in history, and it is indeed a sign of frustration in the development of human society. It is therefore crucially important to trace the manifestations of racism in situations or in societies where ignorance or lack of knowledge prevails in the societies. This increasing general awareness and understanding towards the philosophy of human existence is the principal struggle against such manifestations. which is the key to understand the truth that humankind centers on the creation of the universe, and the key is a return to spiritual and moral values, and finally, the inclination to worship God, the Almighty. The international community must initiate collective moves to raise awareness in the afflicted societies where ignorance of racism still prevails, so as to bring to a halt the spread of these malicious manifestations. Dear friends, today the human community is facing a kind of racism which has tarnished the image of humanity in the beginning of the third millennium. The world Zionism personifies. The world Zionism personifies racism that falsely resorts to religion and abuse religious sentiments to hide their hatred and ugly faces. However, it is of great importance to bring into focus the political goals of some of the world powers and those who control huge economic resources and interests in the world. They mobilize all their resources, including their economic and political influence and world media, to render support in vain to the Zionist regime and maliciously endeavor to diminish the dignity and disgrace of this regime. This is not simply a question of ignorance, and one cannot conquer these ugly phenomena through cultural campaigns. Efforts must be made to put an end to the abuse by Zionists and their supporters of political and international means, and in respect of the will and aspirations of nations, governments must be encouraged and supported in their fights aimed at eradicating this barbaric racism and to move towards reforming. The current reforming the current international mechanisms, there is no doubt that you are all aware of the conspiracies of some powers and Zionist circles against the goals and objectives of this conference. Unfortunately, there has been literature and statements in support of Zionism and their crimes, and it is the responsibility of honorable representatives of nations to disclose these campaigns which run counter to humanitarian values and principles. It should be recognized that boycotting such a session as an outstanding international capacity is a true indication of supporting the blatant example of racism. In defending human rights, it is primarily important to defend the rights of all nations to participate equally in all important international decision-making processes without the influence of certain world powers. And secondly, it is necessary to restructure the existing international organizations and their respective arrangements. Therefore, this conference is a testing ground, and the world public opinion today and tomorrow will judge our decisions and our actions. Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen, the world is going through fundamental changes, rapid fundamental changes. Power relations have become so weak and fragile. The sound of cracks in the pillars of world oppression can now be heard. Major political and economic structures are at the brink of collapse. Political and security crises are on the rise. The worsening crisis in the world economy, for which there can be seen no bright prospect, amply demonstrate the rising tide of far-reaching global changes. I have repeatedly emphasized the need, the change, the wrong direction through which the world is being managed today. And I have also warned of the dire consequences of any delay in this crucial responsibility. Now, in this august and valuable event, I would like to announce here to all leaders, thinkers, and to all nations of the world present in this meeting, and those who have a hunger for peace, economic well-being, that the management, the inequitable and unjust management of the world is now at the end of the road. This deadlock was inevitable since the logic of this imposed management was oppressive. The logic of collective management of world affairs is based on noble aspirations, which centers on human beings and the supremacy of the Almighty God. Therefore, it defies any policy or plan which goes against the interest of nations. Victory of the right over the wrong and establishment of a just world system have been promised by the Almighty God and His messengers, and it has been a shared goal of all human beings from different societies and generations in the course of history. Realization of such a future depends on the knowledge of the creation and the belief in the hearts of all the faithful. The making of a global society is in fact the accomplishment of a noble goal, heralding the establishment of a common global system that will be run with the participation of all nations of the world in all major and basic decision-making processes, and the definite route to this sublime goal. Scientific and technical capacities, as well as communication technologies, have created a common and widespread understanding of the world society and has provided the necessary ground for a common system. Now it is incumbent upon all intellectuals, thinkers, and policymakers in the world to carry out their historical responsibility with firm belief to this definite route. I also want to lay emphasis on the fact that the Western liberalism and capitalism, like communism, has reached to its end, since it has failed to perceive the truth of the world and human as it is. It has imposed its own goals and direction on human beings with no regard for human and divine values, justice, freedom, love, or brotherhood. Has based the living on an intensive competition securing individual and collective material interests. Now we must learn from the past by initiating collective efforts in dealing with present challenges. And in this connection, and in closing my remarks, I wish to draw your kind attention to two important points. One, it is absolutely possible to improve the existing situation in the world. However, it must be noted that this could be only achieved through the cooperation of all countries in order to get the best out of the existing capacities and resources in the world. My participation in this conference is because of my conviction to these important issues, as well as to our common responsibility of defending the rights of nations vis-a-vis the sinister phenomenon of racism, and being with you, the thinkers of the world. Two. Two. Mindful of the inefficacy of the current international political, economic, and security systems on the world scene, it is necessary to focus on the divine and humanitarian values, and by referring to the true definition on human beings, and based upon justice and respect for the rights of all people in all parts of the world, and by acknowledging the past wrongdoings in the past dominant management of the world, undertake collective measures to reform the existing structures. In this respect, it is crucially important to reform rapidly the structure of the Security Council, including the elimination of the discriminatory veto right, and change the current world financial and monetary systems. And change the current world financial and monetary system. It is evident that lack of understanding on the urgency for change is equivalent to the much heavier costs of delay. Dear friends, beware that to move in the direction of justice and human dignity is like the natural rapid flow in current of a river. Let us not forget the essence of love and affection. The promised bright future of the human being is a great asset that may serve our purpose in keeping us together to build a new world and to make a better place, to make the world a better place, full of love, fraternity, and blessings, a world void of poverty and hatred, meriting the increasing blessings of God Almighty and the righteous managing of the perfect human being Let us all join hands in amity, in playing our share, in the fulfillment of such decent new world. I thank you, Mr. President, Secretary General, and all distinguished participants for having the patience to listen to me. Thank you very much.